great name, all condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name.
see the part but not the whole. I know this world is not my home. I want to see Jesus lifted high. I want to see Jesus lifted high. I want to see Jesus lifted. Jesus lifted high. I only have one hope to hold, where sin is crushed and hearts unfold. This King who died and took my place, he stood and walked out of the grave. He stood and walked out of the grave. I want to see Jesus. See Jesus lifted high. I want to see Jesus lifted high.
Yes, I do.
I want to see Jesus lifted high.
You get the last word. You always do. You know the best way.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, driving seas. comforter, my all in all. Here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since death has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
All right. Lord, what an awesome time it is when we can just lift our voices to you. We can be so blessed to be able to make music to you. And Lord, we do stand on that resurrection. We stand fearless today, knowing that you are in control of all things. Thank you, Lord. Now, Father, bless your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Are we rolling? All right. So that was awesome. That was beautiful, you guys. Thank you so much. You did a great job. I really felt the touch of the Spirit when I was sitting back there waiting, and helped my nerves to go away and relax. And boy, what a blessing to have you guys to share that with us this morning. So, hey, we want to talk a little bit to you about, of course, Resurrection Sunday today, and we're very excited to be able to do this. I want to talk to you about some of the appearing of Christ to different people that after he rose from the dead, you know, a lot of people have a real two, three different of course, secondly, there are those who absolutely hang on this resurrection of Jesus because this is our hope. This is the proof of who he is and who we serve on a daily basis in our lives. And there are some that don't even acknowledge the resurrection of Jesus. Maybe you need proof. Maybe you would say this morning, well, if I could see Jesus, then maybe I would believe. But, you know, let me just say this to you. Perhaps if you would believe, you would see Jesus. And that is my prayer for you today. The main reason that the disciples believed in the resurrection is because they saw him alive with their own eyes after he was dead. And he did not appear to them as he looked on the cross. He didn't appear to them even as he looked prior to the cross. He appeared to them in a glorified body. He appeared to them in a body suitable for heaven. And as they were honored and blessed to be able to behold this glory, I think one of the greatest things that we can see this morning is how Jesus presented himself on so many different occasions to his followers. And this morning, I'm hoping that we can draw a correlation between how has Jesus presented himself to you today. They have testified time and time again that they were the very eyewitnesses of his resurrection. It was firsthand evidence. When you go into a court of law, even to this day, you need to have witnesses to prove your case. If there were no witnesses to the resurrection and Jesus were to say, oh, I rose from the dead, how would we know that it really happened unless there were witnesses to make it solid, to make it real for all of us this morning? The disciples knew because they saw the resurrected Lord with their own eyes. Now, the very first thing I want to share with you is the fact that Jesus gave testimony concerning his resurrection. And in the book of Revelation, in chapter 1, he introduces himself to John in the Revelation on Isle of Patmos. And this is what he says to John. He says, don't be afraid. I am the first and the last. And then verse 18 says, I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and death. This is Jesus himself proclaiming his own resurrection, that he was raised from the dead by the power of God. You know, the Bible tells us that as believers in Christ, that when we leave this earth, when we leave these temporal shells that we live in, that we too will be resurrected. And that we're going to be resurrected by the very same power that Jesus was resurrected by. The same power that rose Jesus from the dead this morning lives in us. A quote from a song. What a beautiful song that is, too. I am the living one, he says. I had died and now I'm alive forevermore to never ever die again. Even over in the Gospel of Luke, in Luke chapter 24, we have Jesus again speaking after he rose from the dead. He's appearing to them and he says to them, look at my hands, look at my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have. So here again, we have Jesus testifying of his own resurrection. And to me, that would be plenty good enough. And I'm sure for you this morning, it would be plenty good enough also. But I just want to go over a few passages with you this morning concerning those who did see the risen Lord on that time before he ascended into heaven. Now, over in the book of 1 Corinthians, Paul is writing in chapter 15, and in verses 4 through 8, I would like to read these verses to you. It says, I delivered, verse 4 says, he was buried, and he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. And he was seen by Peter, and then by the 12. And after that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present time, but some have fallen asleep. And after that, he was seen by James, and then by all of the apostles. And then last of all, he was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time. Paul gives us a list, interesting to see that the very first person that we see Jesus, the first disciple he appeared to, being Peter. And I've got to believe this morning that there was something really special about that appearance. Because you remember, Peter denied him. You remember that Peter felt as though he had failed the Lord in a great way, that perhaps there was no going back for Peter. But you know, we all do the same thing, don't we? We fail the Lord in great ways. And because Jesus came to Peter like he did, to reassure him that the resurrection was real, that he was alive, must have brought comfort to Peter's heart, to help Peter not to be too discouraged over his failures. And again, this morning, I think it's important that we take a lesson from this, that Jesus wants to come to you first. He wants to let you know that your failures are not beyond his reach. They are not beyond forgiveness. In verses 13, in the same chapter, it says that if there is no resurrection, then Christ has not risen. If Christ is not risen, then our preaching and everything I'm telling you this morning is empty, and your faith is empty. And we are found to be false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he did raise up Jesus Christ if he did not raise him up. And in fact, if the dead do not rise. And if Christ, oh, this is such an important verse. If Christ is not risen, then your faith is futile and you are still in your sins. Aren't you glad this morning that the truth is that there is a resurrection? That Jesus did rise from the dead? The various appearances that Jesus made to many people after the resurrection, I just want to touch on a few of them this morning because I think each and every one of them is significant. Each and every one of them will probably be something that somebody listening this morning would be able to actually relate to. I hope you can put yourself kind of in this place and imagine that you were there on that day that he rose from the dead. The very first time that Jesus appeared to anybody was to Mary Magdalene. And we read about that in John chapter 20, where it tells us that she had been to the tomb to see what was happening, to perhaps continue the preparation of the body of Christ after the Sabbath had ended. And she was speaking to the angels, and she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there, and she did not recognize him. Now, I'm going to go ahead and turn over here because I want to read it. I don't want to miss anything through this passage because it is very, very powerful. It tells us that Mary was standing outside of the tomb, and she was weeping. And she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. Now when she had said this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And she, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him, "Rabboni." She recognized when he said her name. And he said, "Do not cling to me. I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to the brethren and tell them, I've risen from the dead." Mary had that great opportunity, but she didn't recognize him. And I kind of wonder, was he in disguise? Why didn't she recognize him? A lot of people have asked that question. And if you think about it, you know, it's Sunday morning. The sun is coming up. She's looking into a very, very dark tomb. And she sees these figures inside the tomb, but her distraction leads her back outside again, where it's very bright in the sunlight. And there's a figure standing there. She assumes it's the gardener. Maybe her eyes had not adjusted to the light. Maybe she really couldn't tell. Maybe she had been weeping so much that it was just a blur in her grief. But here's the thing. As soon as Jesus said her name, he knew, she knew who he was. As soon as Jesus called her by name. And he wants to do that this morning for us. Call us by name. Secondly, there was an appearance that Jesus made that was totally, they weren't prepared for. It was unsuspected appearance, you might say. And it was to several people at that time. It was Mary, the mother of James, Salome, and Joanna. And I just want to read the passage about this appearance. It said that Jesus appeared to these three women, and this happened after the appearance to Mary Magdalene. For an angel had told them that Jesus had risen, and they were on their way to tell Jesus' disciples when they met the risen Christ. And Jesus came to them, and he greeted them. Good morning. And they came up, and they took a hold of his feet, and they worshiped him. It's an amazing thing to me to know that on one hand, he's telling Mary not to touch me. And then over here, he's allowing these people to touch him and to worship him. You know, I believe part of the Passover would be that the high priest would approve the sacrifices that were being brought to the altar on Passover. And I believe also that the reason Jesus said, "Do not touch me," that I had to ascend to my Father, he had to present the sacrifice to the Father to be approved, just like the high priest did with the people. And perhaps this is why he would not allow her to touch him at that point. But somewhere between that point and this time right here, evidently he had been approved by the Father, and he allowed them to touch him. And the key is, he allowed them to worship him. You know, this has only happened one other time in the ministry of Jesus, and that was when he was coming into Jerusalem, in the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. He allowed worship to be given to him. Now, Peter, of course, is the first one mentioned in Paul's list of witnesses. He was the first of the apostles to see the Lord risen. And the Gospels are very quiet about this particular event. There's a very short verse in Luke chapter 24, and this is what it says. "The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." That's it. That's all we get. Isn't it amazing? It leaves something to the imagination, doesn't it? Jesus came to Peter first. He appeared to him and he said, "Simon, I'm alive." Peter must have felt real comfort and joy in his heart. Can you imagine what they were going through yesterday? A day of confusion and hiding, a day of seclusion. You know, we find ourselves secluded in our homes this morning. And I think that the disciples were kind of experiencing the same thing, as they were hiding out. They weren't hiding out from a virus, but they were hiding out from a threat from the Roman government. They had taken their leader and crucified him, and the question would be, who's next? And what's going to happen now that our leader is gone? And the confusion that must have been going on in Peter's heart during that time, during that day. To have the Lord appear to him, to appear to Simon, and reassure him. Later that day, on Easter Sunday, he appeared to two disciples that were on the road to Emmaus. They were going home. They were going home from Passover. They had been to Jerusalem, probably in hopes of seeing the Messiah, probably in hopes of being set free, that he would establish his kingdom on the earth. They had great hope as they came to Jerusalem, but as they're leaving Jerusalem and as they're going home, they must be brokenhearted, they must be discouraged, they must be sad, and they find themselves walking down the road to Emmaus, talking about it with one another. It says the two of them were going on that very day to a village named Emmaus, and it was about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all the things that had taken place. And it came about that while they were conversing and discussing, that Jesus himself approached and to begin to travel with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. Now, why they didn't recognize him, I don't know. Once again, it would appear that their eyes weren't open to it. And as it was true with the women, they were not expecting to see Jesus. I know you can be out in public a lot of times, or somebody might drive by you or something, and you've got your mind on other things, and they might go right past you, and you don't even know who it is. You don't even recognize who it is, because that's the last thing on your mind, is that you would see that person. It happens all the time. People see you driving down the road. I saw you driving down the road, and I say, oh, I didn't see you, because my mind was on something else. I could have looked right at you and not known who you were. And I'm wondering this morning if perhaps these men were so discouraged and so heartbroken that as Jesus approaches them, they can't recognize him because of their grief, because of their hopelessness. The beautiful thing is he opens their eyes and he shows them who he is, and their hopelessness turns to hope. There was a final fifth appearance on Easter Sunday. And this took place in the evening, probably in the upper room where they were hiding out, where the Lord perhaps had the Last Supper with his disciples. This story is in Luke and in John's gospel, and he gives two different accounts of the same thing. This is what John wrote. John said, "When therefore it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and when the doors were shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst. And he said to them, 'Peace be with you.' And when he had said this, he showed him both of his hands and his side. And the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. But Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came." So Thomas was out getting groceries, or Thomas was out doing something, but he was not in the room during that time. These men were hiding out for fear. And it's just interesting to me that in the midst of all that turmoil, the first thing that Jesus said to them is, "Peace be with you." You know, he said, "My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, but I give my peace to you." And this is a peace that comes from the presence of God himself. The peace that we can know that even in times of turmoil, even during difficulties, we can have God's peace that passes understanding. So many of you have experienced that in your lives, that you have gone through very difficult times, no matter what that might be. So much variety of things that can happen in our lives. But yet you find yourselves going through it with this sense of peace because you're trusting God. You're believing God. And even though, yes, you are a little bit of afraid inside perhaps, but yet you still sense this peace and God's presence. And this is what Jesus wanted them to experience as he appeared to them in that upper room. Peace be with you in this time of turmoil. 8 days later, he appeared again. This time, Thomas was in the room. And so they were again inside. Thomas was there. The doors were shut. And Jesus came and stood in the midst and said the same thing. Peace to you. Now, I think he was talking to Thomas. I think he was looking right at Thomas when he said this. Because the next few words tells us, he said to Thomas, reach your finger here. Look at my hands and reach your hand over here and put it into my side. Don't be unbelieving, but believing. And you might say again, oh, Thomas got to see it with his own eyes. No wonder he believed. Oh, yeah. But Jesus said, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. That's you and me. That's all of us who put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And when Thomas believed, listen to what he said in response. He said, my Lord and my God. Talk about worship. Talk about proclaiming who Jesus is. There is only one Lord. There is only one God. And Thomas came to the understanding and the realization at that very moment that he was standing in the very presence of the Creator of the universe. Interesting, as time went by, you know, the Lord spent quite a bit of time here on the earth before he went back to heaven, 40 days. And during that 40-day period, there were other appearances that were made. One of them took place on the Sea of Galilee. And the appearances were to seven different disciples out on the Sea of Galilee. And I'll just share that with you. And that's found in the Gospel of John chapter 20. So I'm just going to go ahead and chapter 21, I believe, actually. Chapter 21. It says, after these things, Jesus manifested himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. And he manifested himself in this way. There were gathered together Simon Peter and Thomas, called Didymus, and Nathanael, and Cana of Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. So these men were out, and they were fishing. And it tells us that in verse 2 of chapter 21, Peter, Nathanael, Zebedee, and two others were there. And Simon Peter said, I'm going to go fishing. It's over. I'm going to go fishing. I need to go back to making a living, and I'm going to go back to life as normal. And his disciple, the friends that were there, said, well, we're going to go fishing with you. So they went out and immediately got in a boat, and that night they caught nothing. But when the morning had come, Jesus was standing on the shore, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. And he said to them, children, do you have any food? And they said, no. It's the worst answer you can get from a fisherman. No, we have no food. And so he said to them, cast your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some. Now, I'm pretty certain that automatically Peter was thinking, I've heard that somewhere else before in the last few years. You remember Jesus was telling Peter to throw his net on the other side of the boat when there was no fish to be caught. And they would fish in the evening because the water had cooled down, the temperature cooled down, the fish were more active and easier to catch. In the daytime, they would sink down deep into the cool depths. So in the daytime, you were very unlikely to catch anything. But now as the morning is coming and Jesus is on the shore, and he's just a guy standing on the shore. And they're probably thinking, you know, I've been fishing all my life, and here you are telling me to, I know you can't catch fish during the day out here. Cast your net on the right side of the boat, and you'll find some. So they did. And there were so many fish, it says, that they were not able to draw them in because of the multitude of fish. And that disciple whom Jesus loved, who was John, of course, he said to Peter, "It's the Lord." And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment and he plunged himself into the sea, and he came to Jesus as quickly as possible. And the others followed him. And it's such a cool story because it says as soon as they got to land, there was a fire there. And Jesus was there and he was cooking fish on the fire for them. Isn't that amazing? He had them throw the net in. They caught all of those fish. But you know what? In the end, he was able to provide them that meal that night. He's able to provide you and me with our needs at all times. So many things we can learn from the greatness of this story of those who had the opportunity to see Jesus after he rose from the dead. There's another account in Matthew. He appears before the 11 in Galilee. And they had worshipped him on the mountain. He had designated this mountain to them. And they worshipped him. And the scripture tells us that some were still doubtful. So here you go. We're getting to this point now in our message together that some were doubtful. Where are we at this morning? With all the things going on in our lives, are we still doubtful? Can you see that God's hand is working mightily? Not just in our community, not just in our nation, but in the whole world. He's shaking up the whole world. And he wants us no longer to doubt him. On another occasion, he appeared to over 500 people at one time. And it also tells us that he appeared to his half-brother, James. James would later become a leader in the church. James probably did not believe in Jesus prior to the resurrection. As a matter of fact, scriptures tell us that his family tried to save him from himself on a couple of occasions. They thought he had lost his mind. They thought he was a lunatic. And now come to find out, he is the Messiah. And finally, he appeared to Paul. In appearing to Paul, as Paul was traveling to Damascus, you know the story in the book of Acts. And there was a great light that came around Paul, and he fell to the ground, and he heard a voice asking him, "Why are you persecuting me?" And he said to him, "Who are you, Lord?" He said, "I'm Jesus, who you are persecuting." Interesting. He was persecuting the people. He was persecuting the church. He was persecuting the bride of Christ. But when you persecute the bride of Christ, you're persecuting Jesus. "Why are you persecuting me? Are you the Lord?" he said. He said, "Yes, I'm Jesus." These are the appearances that we have in the New Testament record. It's a lot of evidence. It's not one or two witnesses. It's a lot of evidence to believe that he truly has risen from the dead. He presented himself alive after he suffered. It's so important for us to get this into our heart. The Bible says that Jesus made all of these appearances to prove. He told them over and over, "We're going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to be betrayed. They're going to kill me. And in 3 days, I'm going to rise from the dead. And then you will know that I am." And so this morning, that's the question. Do you know? Do you know the great I am? In this time of uncertainty that we live in now, do you know the great I am? It's time to take off our disguise. It's time to quit running. It's time to quit worrying about hypocrisy, bad representations, people who are not fair, people who are not honest, people who have used the faith to profit for themselves. It's time to forget all of that and just take a look at the risen Jesus, the one who is the great I am, the one who brings you hope this morning, the one who will bring us through all of our trials and all of our tribulations. So I want to encourage you this morning, all of you out there that are listening, I want to encourage you that he is the only hope that you have. I don't know, I see a lot of people putting their hope in and it's nice to be able to clap for people and hang out the windows and holler out of the windows as we're all secluded from one another. That's all great. And you can put your hope in a lot of different things. And right now, people are reaching out to people and putting their hope in people. But let me tell you something, this is going to pass. And then where will your hope be? I want to encourage you this morning, put your hope in Jesus. Trust him. And by the way, another important thing is, he's coming again. When Jesus ascended into heaven, they said, he's going to come in like fashion. We're waiting for that to happen today. The whole world is anxiously waiting for that to happen today. Here is a man that changed history. Here is a man, the only man in the history of humankind that ever defeated death and dies no more. The Lord Jesus Christ. Give your life to him. He loves you. He wants to forgive you. He wants to put you on a path in your life that brings you purpose. Not just Groundhog Day, but purpose. To know that when you're done in this life, that you've done what he's asked you, called you to do, what he's talented you to do, that you fulfilled your destiny. Lord, Father, we are so thankful today. Lord, that we don't have to listen to a fairy tale or hearsay or just some old story that's been passed down from generation to generation. The whole world cries out today, Lord, to you. You're the only one that can hear. You're the only one that can save. And so, Lord, we just ask that you would touch hearts, change lives. May this Easter day, this resurrection day, be resurrection for so many other lives. A new life with you. And we thank you, Lord, that you made that possible through your blood. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
That once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. Thank you.
Okay. Awesome, huh? Praise the Lord. Hey, I just want to quickly let you all know that you've probably seen on the online there, if you have any prayer needs this morning, would you please take the time to call or send us an email or whatever, however you would do that. And I just want to encourage you this morning as we close our time together. I hope that you can have that personal encounter with Jesus. I hope you can have that personal relationship with him, that today might mark that very first day of that resurrection of your spirit in your life. Let us know if there's anything we can pray for you, because we have wonderful prayer warriors. We would love to pray for you. Love your family today. Take advantage of the day and just enjoy it together. God bless you. Thank you for watching.